individuals. I believe we are starting our first game of the day here on Curious Mind, on top of one of the hardest working individuals who has been putting up so many great games throughout the year. It is going to be our lovely purple Protoss player, representing Five Shades of Protoss. He is Trap.
And his opponent in the top left side of the map, going for the gas first. I like it. It is, of course, Team Liquid's Warpig. It's Clem. And honestly, to get hyped for this match, I gotta say, I've been kind of moving my stream schedule around Fear Dragon. I was just doing one of my best game streams where I cast some of the games that get recommended. I just cast a banging match of Trap First Time from a week and a half ago in the Korean Weekly. And it does get me excited for this, because Clem is a micro beast, but dude, Trap is the, I mean, he's the best PvT player in the world. I think Zest is not too far behind him, but dude, I absolutely respect the crap out of Trap. He made a crazy comeback first time in that map that I was just casting a little while ago. So I really think it's going to be fireworks between these two. eBay block comes in. That's a big probe pull. 8 probes? Man.
Yeah, really respecting the heck out of this. He's going to stick some more probes onto that SCV, gets it very low. He's going to be able to pick it off with the engineering bay about halfway finished or close to halfway finished.
The SCV on the other side almost goes down as well, but he barely gets that one back. So, repair.
Does he though?
Oh, we didn't get the repair on it. Yes, he did. Oh no.
Clem.
Slipping up, man. It is very early for Clem. It's only 1 p.m. in France, remember? Mm-hmm. And Clem sleeps at like 10 a.m. every morning normally. So
he's so sad to die so young, you know. It's so unfortunate. But you know, that's life when you go up against the god that is Trap in PvT. I mean, all memes aside and stuff, Trap's PvT has been so sick. And I can say this now that pretty much all, except for I think one of our matches, like we have our rosters and stuff submitted and everything, I have been trying so hard to just get the best lineups and stuff for like each one of these matches. I'm not actually memeing right now. I know it's gonna sound like a meme, but I'm not. I have a notepad where I have psychological profiles on how involved I think each one of the commentators are gonna be with their teams and helping pick the teams who I think is gonna be leading the discussions for which players should go out on which maps and everything. I feel like I've done a decent job just making sure we keep giving Trap TVPs, because he's damn good at them.
It's not a bad way to do it. You know, I was like, hey, it's obviously, you know, it's a good idea, put Trap out, but this is Curious Minds and it's a pretty small map, so definitely some chances for Clem to get aggressive. But dude, I gotta say, obviously I'm cheering for my boy, building a Cyclone here, command center on the high ground, not getting a good delay on the Nexus, and Cyclone versus Twilight, so it's just Cyclone versus Blink opening. It's really bad. Cyclones are not good versus Blink openings. I mean, it's a decent-ish unit. It's just for its cost, its investment, the amount of time it takes to build that with that factory, it's not great. So this is a much better build if he's playing against Stargate, and he is very defensively set up, is Clem. So I really would like to see some extra barracks go down, him get towards that 3 barracks build up. And with the second barracks and the eBay on the way, it does seem like he's headed in that direction, because aggression is always going to be the key of taking advantage of such a small rush distance.
Yeah, it's really interesting to me to see Clem so hunkered down like this. Like you were saying, the safety cycle and everything, staying at home and whatnot. Because when I think of Clem, I think of his biggest strong suits as being an aggressive player and also just being able to have momentum on his side. I know that he's become a much more rounded player and he can actually play a lot better, even if not necessarily like momentum swinging his way. He's able to turn things around a lot better than he used to be, but it is just a very interesting decision to see him playing a little bit more passively in this, you know, game number one. It's a best of one for him, so.
Yeah, he's building a missile turret right now. I mean, I don't know, man. A little bit overly safe. I don't like it. I don't like it. I want to see aggro YOLO Clem. I want to see Caution to the Wind Clem. Explain safe first Trap. It's definitely something which can work, especially since Trap hasn't rushed the third base. I mean, obviously both players are slowed down by these openings, the eBay block. So a 5-minute third is not really that slow, but it's at least not that 4-minute 30 third Nexus that would worry me. More tanks, Stim on the way, and only a third gas for Trap, which makes me think he might go Mass Stalker Zealot, rather than going up to the splash damage. If he doesn't drop the fourth gas really soon, he just can't really afford Storm or Colossus. So it might be a very low tier mid game battle that we're looking at.
Yeah, and I mean, Clem is finally set up. He's going to be looking to do a little move out over here, and all the stalkers do have blink. They're going to be poking away at that marauder. Love that as a first target. He is going to end up losing one of his stalkers in exchange for getting some damage on the cyclone. Cyclone will probably get repaired up for a little bit. That'll delay Clem from pushing out any further, but you know, kind of not exactly the most ideal trade. Just get a marauder in exchange for a stalker.
Yeah, no, you want to get those free pickoffs. If he got the Cyclone, it would have been great for Trap. I mean, the thing is, he pushed Clem back inside his base, and Clem's just sitting there, which means Trap feels more confident now. He's like, cool, get a shield battery up on my third, get the Immortal. I also like that he took that straight line third. Much harder for Terran to push that, of course. The front third, a little bit maniacal if you're going for that as Protoss. It doesn't make a lot of sense against a Terran player, and all those upgrades starting to come in. No Forge for Trap just yet. He's going to be heading on up to 5 gateways, probably 8 gateways pretty soon.
Oh, very bold move over here with these stalkers. Ends up losing quite a few of them. He's going to lose one more to the Cyclone. I think that's maybe 3 or so stalkers that actually ended up going down there in exchange for that tank. And hey, I mean, killing off a tank is nice since Clem isn't exactly making more tanks right now. Instead, he's building more reactors with his factory, but it's definitely a costly little trade over there.
Yeah, cost inefficient. And if you're going a Mortal Zealot, do you care about tanks? Not really. Like, tanks are good if you're going Colossus, right? They're good at ranging your army. But Zealot Immortal is going to jump on top anyway. So definitely, you don't want to be throwing these Stalkers away and Trap. Now they're all very wounded. You can't really pick off any more Marauders. Yeah, you get some Marine, almost get some Marauder, but this Medivac's here now. Another Stalker goes down. Ooh, that juicy Central US server advantage. Happy we use that for this one.
Well, we have a few more gateways going to be finishing up. More Zealots have been warped in. It looks like Trap is really, really testing the waters over here. All the Marauders are actually leading the charge on this side here for Clem. So those Immortals get some big juicy shots off if they have an opportunity. And looks like Clem is going to go ahead and pick up one of the Siege Tanks and just head on home. He feels like not a whole lot he can do over here.
Zealot run by does get shut down really hard, so this is awesome. I love the pullback. I mean, I think too many players just sit there with their army and let the Protoss choose when to fight with it, but they're kind of pushing forward, threatening, pulling back, pushing forward, picking a fight, pulling back. That's a much more dangerous way to play it, and I really wish he knew about this pylon. Did Clem getting rid of that pylon? He sees it now and he's like, oh, okay, because that's basically, it's a very, very cheap warp prism right now. Of course, a warp prism is entering the field. But Trap does not have splash damage. He does not have a fourth base. And yeah, Clem's third is now up and mining. And I think this feels very good for me. If Clem can keep building these numbers, he's got upgrades. And if he can pick a fight before Storm kicks in, it's a scary next couple of minutes for Trap, who has a warp prism out in the middle of nowhere.
Ooh, yeah, gonna see what that War Prism is gonna be able to do. Is able to actually get to the Zealots, pick some of those up, and get into a more interesting location where it can maybe be a bit more effective continuing the harassment and stuff. But I think that War Prism, I mean, as long as this doesn't get picked off by the Cyclone, it will be able to potentially buy some time over here as Clem ends up retreating all the way back into his third base.
It's in.
Storm should finish up.
Yeah, Widowmine drops really nice there. It doesn't get a massive amount of probes, but even just like a bit of denial here, it's just so cheap. Pulls Trap home, gets a bit of mining time, 4 probes and a Stalker, and it allows his army to move through the north. Prism is coming in. There's a Cyclone there, but the Zealots will be able to unload on it. Ah, damn it. It does go down.
Yeah.
Obviously, he's got a bunch of units coming up from the rally, though. As long as he doesn't eat Storm, guess what? Storm's not quite done. As I say it, it finishes. Watch out.
Okay, that Storm doing a little bit of damage, but not that much just yet. Shield battery also going to be under fire over here, but it looks like Trap is able to secure at least a little bit more space and isn't quite taking too much damage. And you can already see Clem is starting to back up with some of these units. Doesn't even get the shield battery just yet.
Yeah, he's keeping him off the fourth base right now. And Trap's army is way smaller. The question is, though, if he gets flanked or stormed. Oh, stop running around in a ball versus Storm, Terran players. Don't do that anymore, Clem. No. You pre-spread those units, please. Got to watch out. If he can bring his rally forward, that'd be really nice. I think, honestly, Clem needs to pull out right now. He's going to get jumped on otherwise. And if he gets, like, Storm dropped, obviously he'll get cleared really efficiently. If he can get some value, that would be nice. But shield batteries are good. He gets a High Templar for a Marauder. Ooh, make it 2 or 3 Marauders. Oh, nice hot pickups to save one of them. And he's going to lose this position now. Time to get the hell out of there. He's going to stim away, but he's going to deny the fourth and run six Widowmines in as well. Why not? Go for it, son.
All the Widowmines are actually going to be going off, but the Zealots drag them on to most of the bio, and looks like the rest of the Widowmines end up actually getting picked off over there. The Observer's still alive and outside the range of that scan, so a lot of those Widowmines go down. Third base just going to get focus fired down over here for a moment, but ends up seeing some Stalkers warping in. Funny enough, I actually think that Clem could have gotten that Nexus, but just the Stalker reinforcements, it seems like it scared him off.
Yeah, this is actually kind of crazy at this point because Trap has a very scary army, and with his micro, he's very good at taking offensive storm engagements, and I think he feels like he has to right now. And most of the bio gets away on the south side of the map. Clem, of course, has way more stuff, and his ghosts and his 2-2 are on the way. Clem is miles ahead. If he gets this fourth established, like, Clem is so far ahead in this game, he just needs to be very careful right now at avoiding storms, force fields, and immortals. And he's got a pre-spread. He's doing this exactly right. The Stalkers can't find much. The Widowmines will do it. The pre-spreads are great. Clem just has to keep it in his pants right now.
Man, these pre-spreads are really, really solid right now from Clem. They are really denying the ability for these High Templars to find big storms. Even with the ghosts and everything, trying to go for the EMPs on the Warp Prism, it's not really landing, but Trap just hasn't been able to find the big storms he's looking for. And like you said, the lack of Forge, the lack of upgrades, I would say, has really been problematic. The Warp Prism, oh, it goes down. I think there's one or two High Templars in there as well.
Ooh, that's such a bummer because it should have been Clem who was more distracted as the Zealots came in. But he's walled off his mineral line really nicely. So if the Zealots want to get in there, they have to really commit. That's why he has to kind of pull out of that situation a little bit earlier than he otherwise would have. Clem is maxed out against a Protoss who's only now starting his disruptor transition. Trap is hanging on for dear life. If anyone can come back from here, it is Trap. But Clem is looking to push in and deny this fourth base. He's picking off expensive units. And Clem says, all right, man, a time to get a little bit of momentum going. Time to start racking up these wins for the War Pigs. And he is punishing Trap on Curious Minds.
Disruptor number one coming out. Disruptor number two also pops on out. How much damage can they get done? The Medivacs have obviously seen that high ground, know that the Disruptors are there. There's going to be a little bit of zoning action going on, but unless that second Disruptor can get a massive connection, Trap is going to be in a very, very difficult spot to come back in this situation. Clem really just playing quite well today.
Yeah, Stray Ball does get stomped on there. Time to pull back for Clem. His army's way too weak on the bottom, so there's no reason for this army to stay here. Obviously, he wants to keep fighting, but he should pay attention to his medevac energy and his hit points and realize that his army is very fragile. I mean, I guess he's maxed, so he's like, screw it. Let's just keep trading, man.
Yeah, his army is very stimmed up right now, but he's still doing a good job dodging out of the storms and everything. I mean, if for Trap to actually turn the situation around, you have to remember he is three base versus four, so he needs to not only take a really amazing army engagement, he also needs to be able to have another base.
Oh,
the flank comes in over here. GG.
GG, a very important match there. One where you did expend your player Fear Dragon, throwing out your best player on the map that is most Terran favored. It was a Chad move, and I admire. I'm not going to rub salt in the wound, because honestly, if it paid off, I'd be like, God, I just lost my best player on the Terran map. God damn it. So I'm actually very happy that we made it through that map. That's really important for us.
Well, here's the thing about this pig is that I sort of knew, you know what? Clem is a damn good player. Trap is also a damn good player, but at the end of the day, every single one of these matches, I think, is reasonable for either team to win, actually. I think that all of our players actually match up really well against each other. For those who don't know, like, the following matchups are a Laser versus Mana, which I actually think is pretty reasonable to go either way. Neeb versus Nice, which again is also, I think, an even match. Dream versus Astraea, which I think some people will give to Dream, but I actually think Astraea is actually going to put up a damn good fight there and might be a little bit favored. And we have Zound versus Cure.
I actually disagree with you, man. I think Neeb is the favorite over Nice. And I think Astraea Dream is very close, but recent form, Astraea has been beast mode. So I actually think, you know, your guys are more favored there than you might think about it. What do you think about Cure Zound?
I don't want to make you feel too bad. I just didn't want you to feel too bad.
I think Cure is favored versus Zound, though.
Okay.
Do you agree or nah?
I don't think anyone's actually favored versus us. I think you just have a fighting chance versus us in all these matches. Look, you don't have bad players, they're just not as good as mine, so.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure they all have attributes. I'm sure they're good at hanging out in the shower in those you know, denim cutoffs and scrubbing each other's back and team mentality. Probably they're pretty good at puns, I'm imagining, since you've
they're also very good at swapping to the correct server for the next match, by the way. It should be Europe.
Yeah.
Yeah. We're in America? What? Oh, yeah. Okay. Never mind. I'm on the... See, they're very good at this. I, on the other hand, am not, so...
Yeah. No, we'll move it around. Technical issues that will be sorted. So, anyways, I like that. Fear Dragon getting on his high horse and having a little roll around.
And being
honestly,
wrong.
We're only just starting, and Pride of Altaris is about to come up next, and Pride is great. Because this map gets vetoed too much, but you can't veto a map in a team league, can ya? So we get to see a lot more Pride, Blackburn as well. We get to see a fair bit more. Well, what other maps do you think we get to see a bit more of that normally get vetoed? For me, it's those two that come to mind.
Yeah, Pride and I think sometimes Curious Minds, I think, can...
Yeah, Curious, that does make sense.
Vetoed a bit, but... Yeah, it's... you know what? I will say, even though I know that Pride is definitely looked at as a very Zerg-favored map and everything, I still enjoy watching a lot of the games on it. I enjoy watching and seeing what kind of creative things players can pull out on it, especially, like, I think some of the more creative Protoss players have come up with some fun solutions to the problems that you face going up against the Zerg in the early game on this map.
Oh, absolutely. Gold-based shenanigans are very scary. And, you know, sometimes it's almost not taking the gold base and the other opponent just being worried about it or trying to force it themselves ends up being the mistake. Sarah Raynor recently at Katowice, right? Raynor was like, yeah, hatch first on the gold. And Sarah was like, I'm just going to play the most standard style and I'll just run the occasional pair of banelings into the mineral line. But other than that, I'm just going to occasionally faint with Zerglings and just macro. And yeah, and he took Raynor down because Raynor, with that exposed gold base, was like, oh, I gotta build units like at any sign of aggression because you're so exposed out there. So that being said, we've seen a fair few Protoss players take the gold base, build a robo at it, and do like a little Immortal Prism gateway push off 4-5 gateways, full wall their main base so that they can't get counterattacked there. Some interesting things do happen, but while we're getting into this and we're getting back into the game and you're here and I'm here and whatnot, Fear Dragon, we have a question from Washong on the Kickstarter questions. Fear Dragon, if Stats was playing, would you have taken Stats over Trap as your number one player?
So here's the thing, is that the answer is no. And I'm a big Stats fan. I think Stats is great, but I wouldn't have broken up the gang, man. Like, this is the War Chest Team League gang plus Zhaun. This is just the new team. We have the exact same team as the War Chest Team League team. We added one player. You know, I would have considered maybe adding Stats as like a fifth player, but I think we got the best team possible. I don't think I would have changed anything.
I like that answer. And for those who don't know, War Chest Team League, of course, a few years ago. So, you know, this is kind of becoming a bit of a franchise. And if you think about, you know, popular sports teams, there's a lot that just trade players. They always buy the new best ones, very little loyalty. Mm-hmm. And, you know, maybe they have one or two star players they keep or veterans for a long time that are kind of the anchor of the team community and that sort of thing. And that's my team. You know, we're the teams that win. I have Dream from my previous team. He's still bringing the Warpig spirit. He's you know, initiating the other guys into the culture, how we do things. But I've changed it up and I've just grabbed the best players available. Meanwhile, your team, Sentimental, it's really awesome. Loyalty's there. But, you know, being bottom three on the ladder in the NFL every year, not as exciting when, you know, basically people show up to the stadium expecting to lose.
So here's the thing, Pig, is that all of these players are actually the best players that were available for every round. And really, anytime that they lose, it's just because I didn't utilize them as well as I could have. I did not put them out in the right context. And that's the only real time or reason that they end up losing. Every other time, it's really just on me.
Indeed.
Well, I think we're starting up on my player. We're going to be up here on the top left-hand side of Pride of Altaris on top of the purple Protoss player. He is Mana.
All right. And down in the bottom right side of the map, the Zerg player, he is in the pink, befitting a war pig. It is, of course, XCOM. I go a laser. I think XCOM's the old. Is that the old? Or is that actually the active sponsor? I don't even know. Anyways, he's a war pig. That's what matters the most today. We do, of course, love the players' teams as well, but sometimes I am incompetent and don't remember. That's going to be a pool gas pool opening from a laser. So that's actually really cool to see kind of how that goes there and exactly what's going to happen in that regard. The probe came across very early for Mana, so he kind of wants to see what's happening, but it's just going to be the gas pool into the gold base as a very safe way of taking that gold. And very cool to see a laser just saying, hey, all right, I want to secure it, but I don't want to just lose 3 or 4 drones to the first 2 adepts.
Yep. Nice way to just sort of secure that forward base. And I really want to see how is Mana going to be reacting? What are the adaptations you're going to make on a map like Pride of Altaris? We do end up seeing just kind of the little wall off and stuff coming up as Mana just takes his natural expansion. So nothing too crazy GS yet. But it is definitely, it's an annoying thing, not only because of the gold base being a gold base where you have the extra income and everything as a Zerg player, but also just, it's a lot more forward. It's a lot faster to get those reinforcements to the other side of the map if a laser does want to actually start getting aggressive. So Mana has to be a little bit wary about that potential as well.
It's not just me that wants to see a forge when Zergs take the gold, right? Like, when, I know I'm cheering for a laser, but I'm like, dude, drop a forge, you know, just like cannon rush that shit. Even if it's gas pool like this, it's so far out.
Yeah.
And, you know, I feel like that would be kind of cool. Obviously, I don't know what happens in that scenario, but I play a lot of North American ladder, Robbie. It infects your brain, man. It rots your brain after a while. Like, you start to think the answer to everything, Virtus, is like, I should have built cannons earlier in a different position. You know,
it is what it is. Yeah, you are speaking my language there with that, but I think it's not as much the cannon rush kind of player. So he is instead going to go for the Stargate. He's going to try and play this out a little bit more standard looking, I would say, all things considered. And well, even I would say the lings over here for a laser are actually being pretty defensive. Like, he made these 4 lings and everything in case the adept decided to move across the map over to the gold base, but he's not even poking them around on the other side of the map. He's just going after the rocks, kind of opening up the pathways and making the gold a little easier to, I want to say easier to defend, but in some ways it's harder to defend, right? If you knock down those rocks. Yeah, I can't hear you, Pig.
Oh, sorry. I muted my mic while I was coughing, and then I stopped coughing and didn't unmute it. Yeah, it's an attack path for the Zerg, right? It's really good for walking queens forward, something like that. Also good for the Protoss to attack you, so yeah. We'll see how it goes. It's such a standard opening. I do think Mana's been skimping on his chrono boost usage a little bit. I think now he's chronoing probes, but I think he could have done that a bit earlier, and a supply block on 46 as well. No super quick third base. Feels like Mana's saying the answer to this gold is to play the most generic normie game ever. And I'm going a laser. Please don't. Okay, 44 supply block is finally done. He's building a lot of Zerglings right now. I really hope he just drones super hard because, yeah, he's got the income lead with the gold base. But I really think this should be the sort of setup where if a laser's just confident enough to be greedy, he gets way ahead. But without the information, it's hard to make that call.
Well, Mana's going to have that first Oracle that popped on out. He's going to spot a couple of these lings making their way across the map. The Void Ray going to be walking past that Zelnaga Watchtower. Where are the rest of the lings? I know these, like, there's 3 or 4 lings that went over to the third base there for Mana. The rest of the lings a little bit further behind. Oracle and Void Ray making their way back.
Ooh, fancy Ling Micro as well. Even pulled back one of the lings there to keep it alive for a moment longer. And he is going to get a cancel on that Nexus. A laser. Getting a cancel on the third, that's so rare to get these days, especially with 3 Adepts and a Void Ray and an Oracle out, but that's a huge win for him. He now goes back to droning. He has a Roach Warren on the way, 3 more queens as well. 9 queens are going to be out. Woof! And Mana very slow to retake his third, making charge and mass gateway. Fear Dragon! I think Mana might feel like he wants to do a bit of a Zealot Arc on YOLO after losing the third.
Yeah, oh, I'm really worried right now, Pig. There's this one Overlord coming in toward the from the main base on the right-hand side. If it moves in, it's going to see all of the gateways. It's going to have a very good read on everything. And Mana's sitting over here. He's trying to, like, fake out +1 air weapons and stuff. He's like, oh, the Lings come in. They see +1 air weapons researching. But as soon as the laser pops in that main base, so that Overlord, yeah, that's a perfect scout.
Ooh, Oracle does slide by the main base, but I mean, it's going to get taken out by these queens or at least get very low. Ooh. And the Overlord sees so many gateways finishing and immediately a spine at the gold. You've got 10 queens going 12 queens. What the hell, a laser? Oh my God, what a savage. He's going to play Mass Queen Roach. That's such a tanky comp. It's going to be hard for Mana to take this out. I mean, he doesn't even have a Templar Archives. This is just Charge Zealots. And there's only 10 of them right now. I think a laser can get enough units together to survive this.
Oh yeah, this is going to be a really tough army to break. There's so many queens with all the roaches about to pop out as well. I mean, the best thing that I would say a laser or a Mana has going for him is that he did manage to supply block a laser for a little bit. So some of the reinforcements will be a little bit slower. Some of the queens actually getting off of creep, not able to transfuse over there. Two of the queens go down very quickly. Are these Zealots going to be able to hold the line against so many units? They need to be able to break through at some point. There's a good concave going on these queens, but oh, these transfuses make it so hard to break.
Yeah, queens are so tanky, man, and that they do their job. The roaches in the back do the damage. The zerglings surround the adepts. Up 15 workers, and that is going to be that. Hot diddly damn, mate. That is a GG, and a laser gets his gold. And yeah, Mana tried to play a very normal straight-up opening, but we see how cheap it is to do a Bling Flood, get the cancel on the third, and it kind of shepherded Mana into a rather one-dimensional direction. That Overlord Scout, very crucial for a laser.
Yeah, nice scout there from a laser. He's able to react really, really well. You know, Mana, he put up a good effort. He bit the bullet for the Protoss team and took on Pride of Altaris. He gave it a shot. I gotta say, it's not the end of the world. Even though, you know, looks like the series isn't going that well, I think this is where we really do hit our stride, though, because I think these next two matches, feeling pretty damn good about. I'm feeling pretty good about Neve versus Nice coming up as our next match, as that is going to be a nice one for us, I would say.
We'll see how it goes. The Battle of the Blink Stalkers, definitely, you know, it's, I mean, it's got to feel good for you, because I believe the matches will be played on North America, which is always going to favor those Americans, aren't they?
Finally nice to get a little server preference at long last, just because, you know, you won the coin toss, so you actually get most of the server preferences, but we'll finally get one here.
How does that actually work, though? Is America versus Korea ever played on Korea? Or is it always America? I'm wondering.
I think it actually... I believe it depends on the event. But I know that some events, it'll like alternate between Korea and West if you have a player that's like from US West. Like an Estrella would be a good example.
If they're Estrella, if they're West Coast. Yeah, Wardy says only if they're West Coast. That makes perfect sense. I was about to say, like, Neve is not. If they're West Coast. Neve will always get the server advantage, like playing US West, where he'll play with, like, I don't know, 80 ping. Korean player probably plays with 130 ping, I would imagine, to US West from Korea. I don't know exactly. It's been a long time since I've ladded NA from Korea. I'm not sure if the ping is the same as it was 10 years ago, but probably in the low 100s region. So it should be very, very microable and playable.
Yeah, I think that is the nice thing, is that I can say as a US West player, like the ping from here to Korea, and I imagine it's not that different from Korea to US West, it's pretty manageable. It's actually pretty doable to just do that. I'd say actually ever since the BattleNet bug has been happening, where I basically take 25 minutes to log on to North America on my main account, I've been playing a lot more Korea, and it's, you know, it's really not that bad.
I always like it, because whenever I haven't played Korea in a long time and I go over there, I'm always just, there's culture shock at just how bloody good everyone's micro is. But you know, it takes a while before they know how to spend their money, but there's bronze players with pretty decent micro. Anyways, I'll let you intro your boy.
All right, guys, down here in the bottom left-hand side of Blackburn, we have the purple Protoss player from Five Shades of Protoss. He is Neve.
And his opponent in the bottom right, he is the goodest of good gamers. He is a war pig, and he's in the pink befitting a pig. It is Noice. That's not a noise. This is a noise.
Yeah, how has Nice been holding up so far in your team league matches and stuff? I think there were a few people who were kind of there were doubters, and you know what I gotta say, Pig? I think Nice is actually a pretty damn good player. So I didn't hate the pick and everything, but I'm curious, how has he been doing so far?
So we've only played two matches, right? Because we're playing all yesterday was our first two matches, and then today, tomorrow, so it's all coming in at once, right? So we've only played two matches. Nice did lose both, but his first match was really close with Prince. I think he got a bit stubborn with trying to force Blinkstalkers for the win, which I think Neeb does fantastically well. I think he's the best in the world. And I was actually referencing Neeb when saying, hey, this is how this can work. But if you just never transition and you don't have an economy lead, eventually the Immortals and the Disruptors and the Archons and the Zealots do just trade a bit better. So he went down in that one. And he played Showtime, and Showtime did Showtime things, was a bit of a wall, got a bit of a lead, and then just kind of overwhelmed him, as Showtime does tend to do. So it was a really good defense of the Oracle and the Adepts and all that sort of stuff. So interesting to see if Nice can turn it around. He's been copying some really hard matchups. So honestly, for me, Nice is one of my fifth pick player. It's not saying, oh, he's a throwaway, he's bad or anything like that. But he actually has happened to also run into a lot of number one, number three seed players and that sort of stuff. Number two seeds on all the other teams, looking at the future lineups for the next few days as well. So if he can like win just a map here or there, he's actually outperforming what the Aligulac predictions or anything like that would be on paper. So for Nice, like taking down Neeb, I think he's an underdog in this match. But if he can do it, it would be absolutely smashing. Obviously, it would get us the win here. At least three wins to get that. All maps are played out no matter what for those who are just tuning in for the first time. Now, this proxy starport is really cute from Neeb. I've never seen someone proxy there. And that's why Nice isn't checking. He's checking everywhere else. And he's like, what are you doing, dude? He's building a void ray. A shield battery will not be done in the main in time. So I really hope he sends that void ray up to the main base.
Yeah, it's actually unfortunate for Nice. He even checked his own location, like kind of on the mirrored side for his own side of the map, expecting the proxy to be over there, but Oracle's coming on forward. Void Ray is going to be popping soon over here for Nice, but it's popping out over at the natural expansion, so this Oracle will get some nice damage done on Nice's economy. Oh my god, six workers already is really beautiful damage.
5 seconds late on a shield battery is an eternity, and it's one of those things, right? 5 seconds late in most scenarios doesn't matter for timings in StarCraft, but when it's an Oracle coming in and your battery's a few seconds late, it really matters. And that's one of those frustrating things where Nice is like, ah, really? Just off by 5 seconds? Gosh. So he's gonna no doubt be a little annoyed at that. Gonna have to chrono probes pretty bad. He's gone a void rate and now a phoenix as well. I mean, he's got to catch these oracles. If he's got a void ray and a phoenix, he's definitely got to catch those and then start making his way towards blink. But that worker advantage, already six for Neeb, very rough situation for Nice.
Neeb was actually just going to try and sacrifice his oracles for a little bit more damage. Actually, or at least I thought he was, but the phoenix ended up running away as the oracles came in. So Neeb gets out of there alive with both of these oracles. Now the phoenix is going to be trying to find the oracles. He's gonna end up finding them. Recall's gonna come out, but it is a little bit tough when the oracle's already so low. So one of the oracles goes down. That means the shield battery's gonna be a lot more effective there. But I mean, damage already done at this point.
Yeah, gonna go Robo Gateways. So that makes me think Nice is maybe thinking about an all-in. He's got a Void Ray out there. He's gonna kill his Stargate. Supplied locked on 46 is nice, so not a great situation. He does find the Oracle again and sees, look at this beautiful Blinkstalker transition for Neeb. Neeb going four gateways, and I think from here, Neeb should probably take a gold base while also proxying a gateway, and then just like basically never letting Nice get a third, getting a gold for himself. And it's... I'm looking at the numbers, and unless Nice goes straight Disruptors, Sneaky DT, something like this, he's not going to get back in it with standard play. So I'm really looking at what's the curveball, what's the special tactics. Nice, it's time to dig into your bag of tricks and just, you know, put on your Haas costume. Think what would a just completely psychotic maniac who's just gotten out of the Arkham Asylum or something like that, what would he do right here? Because you cannot play completely straight up from here. You're very far behind.
Yeah, man, those Taiwanese Protoss players do have some tricks up their sleeves oftentimes. I think Nice, he's got those two modes of being extremely cheeky or being a little bit more standard. But yeah, he's still just leaning more toward the standard route. He's adding on his third base. He's dropping down additional shield batteries as he's seen the proxy gateway here from Neeb. But as he's seen that proxy gateway, Blink is about to finish up over here for Neeb. He's going to end up being able to pick off a couple of these stalkers. Some great pickoffs here for Neeb to start things off.
And those batteries are not going to be able to get up. Phoenix tries to do a lift. Void Ray tries to turn on its prismatic alignment. Force Fields tried to do something. But as I said, Nice is just too far behind. Immortals Void Ray is Forge on the way. Third base here. It's not going to be enough. Neeb is just too far ahead off of that first Oracle. And he was already chrono boosting probes like a madman behind it.
There we go. That's one on the board for the boys. Five shades of Protoss. Picking one up against a Protoss player.
Yeah, it's bad luck. Bad luck there for Nice. I mean, just a few seconds late on that shield battery, but that was a really quick Stargate. To check the timing, 2 minutes and 2 seconds. That's a very crisp proxy Stargate timing, mate. That is.
I love it.
Beautiful.
Really, really well done, and did a great job with the positioning on that to keep it well hidden, I gotta say. But that's gonna be one on the board for not only Five Shades of Protoss, but also for Neeb, who I know he's been looking to get that first W on the board for us for this series. And not gonna lie, it feels good, especially since we were doing really well versus, I would say, Rotterdam's team, but actually it was the PvPs that were rough for us. So it feels good. We're winning those PvPs now, all right? We turned things around since last week.
You guys later today are playing Benny and the Boys as well, so you're gonna have three PvPs in that one.
Yeah, we're playing so many matches today, man. And then we're playing another match.
Oh, you got three
well.
Today. Oh wow.
Yeah. Well, and I'm not even moving this week or anything. Nader, busy like you.
I do like that the final series you guys versus the goat in the gang, so we get the ZVP smorgasbord of like, how did the patch change Zerg versus Protoss? You know, you got Armani, Serral, and I think it's Lambo, right? On that team, I think.
Yep.
Yeah, Serral, Lambo, Armani. Mana Trap Astraea. So that's going to be awesome to see how all those play out.
I was very grateful that Wardy rigged everything. I you know, slipped maybe a few $100,000 or something into Wardy's pocket, and he was just like, I got you, Fear Dragon. Goat in the gang, yeah, we're not going to make you play Pride of Altars for that series. Yes, thank you.
My man.
Yeah.
Oh, good shizzle. Good shizzle, my dizzle. Well, I think we've got time for another Kickstarter question really quickly as we start this one, mate. When your team wins, what are your party plans for your dragon?
Ooh, that's a good question. I feel like party plans for our team for Five Shades of Protoss, definitely going to be immediately going to Twitter and saying, aren't Protoss players just harder working? We're all just going to actually then go to karaoke, and we're just going to be sitting there singing, relaxing, and reading all of the rage tweets from all the Terran and Zerg players that are responding to it as we, you know, maybe drink a little soju or something. I feel like that's a solid plan.
Okay, well, that sounds all right. Well, me being Australian, I am going to basically, we're going to get on a group call. We're going to do a Zoom shoey together. So we're all going to, I'm going to force every one of my boys to pour a beer into their shoe and on camera. So we have proof and evidence and I'll record it. We're going to basically ruin a pair of our own shoes, each of us will, and drink some of our own foot muck while also spilling it on our keyboard and desk. It's going to be a good time. It's going to be awesome. Maybe we'll go out for a barbecue. I'll take the lads out for a barbecue at the next event. It's going to be a good time. It's going to be good, man.
I can get behind that. I can get behind that. Wardy is typing something to the chat. Oh, he erased it before I could read it. It's on the preview monitor. He's too fast. Anyways, introduce the players.
All right, who's first? We got Dream in the top right. He's a war pig. Dream.
And down here in the bottom left-hand side, we have our purple Protoss player. Five Shades of Protoss is Astraea.
So were you, by the way, were you in the chat? I know you were in my channel just before we went live. Were you there when I was shit-talking this matchup?
No, I was not, but I mean...
So I was,
it doesn't
I was doing
surprise me that you have to make up for, you know, the lack of skill that Dream is going to have coming into this with, you know, shit talk. I mean, I feel like the results are going to speak for themselves in this one. So I don't really feel like I need to put down Dream.
That's all right. As always, you know, there's the high road and the low road. You always take the low road, Ravi. I actually was not shit talking Astraea. I was shit talking both of them equally. I said, no matter what happens, this is going to be a banger. Because whenever these two play, there's fireworks. And the reason is, whichever one of them gets a lead... will throw that lead and then the other one will get ahead and then he'll throw that lead. Both of these guys are very good macro strategic players. But when they play against each other, they have a tendency to attack badly and throw away armies. I'm not saying it's, obviously now I'm building it up and then, you know, it's going to be like a one-sided 6-minute game or something, who knows. But really, they have these, they both are really good at making comebacks because they're both macro beasts. Astraea, obviously we talk about how he can take a punch better than anybody. He rebuilds his probes really hard. But I was like, man, yeah, I was like, no, Astraea can't hang on to a lead for his life though. He gets way ahead. He's good at making comebacks when he throws it away. As soon as I said those words, Astraea popped up in my chat and he was like, oi, what? And I was like, yeah, man. I was like, what the hell? This is what happens every time these two play, dude.
You know, Astraea is just, he's getting a lead and then he's giving it up so that he can get better practice, okay? You know, I understand. You as someone who's not very in touch with the road to improvement doesn't fully understand the value of making sure that you can make the most of your practice time. I mean, why would you want to restart the game back at 0-0 again in the next ladder game when you just have a perfectly well set up game you could just make into a playable situation again very quickly? It's actually more efficient practice.
Well, back on the strategy just for a moment, this is really bad for Astraea. 3cc is so macro heavy, and he's gone Phoenix, which is really good for shutting down like Hellion drops, Mind drops. Can't do anything against a guy who's just building 3 racks after 3cc. And he hasn't even scouted the command center yet. He needs to see that command center. At least he does spot it.
Mm-hmm.
And immediately Astraea is going to be like, oh crap, I need to take a third base as quickly as possible, get Colossus going. Because Dream is just going to have so much stuff so early. And there's nothing you can do about it. He knows that it's Phoenix. He's seen it. So Dream's just like, cool, keep Marines covering the main mineral line, Marines covering the natural mineral line, mule my ass off. And when Stim shields and medevacs are out, he's going to have a third base landed and Astraea's just going to be having to turtle up and try and survive.
Yeah, that part is definitely going to be a little bit tougher for Astraea. We'll see what damage he can actually get done with these Phoenix, as well as Dream is doing a nice job kind of spreading out his Marines, getting ready and different angles to push back any of the Phoenix to try and go for these lift-ups. Lift-ups might actually just go off on these Marines as they're starting to pop out over here. So picks off 2 of them. I don't hate it. Just at least knocking down a little bit of the size of the army. Just finding any damage you really can at this point.
Astraea is being very intelligent right now in that he cut Phoenix on 2. He's now adding a third, but it's low priority. He's like, no. Get the Colossus, get the third. Don't miss a beat on the probes. Go to the Forge, go to the Twilight. There's a lot of players out there, Protoss players, that I criticize for when they realize they need to be greedy and they still just follow their build. And they're like, cut probes to get my, you know, my extra Phoenix, cut probes to get an extra thing. And I'm like, dude, you're up against a 3cc. You just got to hold the probe key down. If there's anyone who can keep pace and even outpace a 3cc opening with a kind of dodgy Phoenix opening, it's definitely Astraea. That's why I do hope Dream has a very solid plan for the next minute or two from here, as all those upgrades are going to be coming in. And in the next probably 30 seconds, he should be pushing out with his first 2 medevacs. And Astraea grabs a couple of SCVs, not too much. Still only on 2 gates is Astraea. Doesn't have that Viagra upgrade for the Colossus going just yet, but the tech is spotted by Dream.
Ah, yes, the Viagra upgrade. The upgrade that I'm sure we all know is Thermal Lance.
Yeah. Got to extend that.
Got to be coming up,
mate. That beam. Got to make it long and thick.
And you know, it's nice to cast with you again, Pig. I forget all of your creative names for things when we're not at premiere events.
It's rare I get to cast like a nice, like top players, you know, prize pool important tournament like this. And I also get unchained. And you know what, mate? You let a war pig off its chain. Sometimes it goes a bit feral. So we'll see how it goes. He has, so now he's forgotten Viagra completely. At this point, he's not going to remember it until the 13 minute mark, dude. He should have started it by now. Second Colossus starting before it is okay, but usually you'd start the medevac right after.
Gets a medevac. That is a beautiful pickoff. And actually, the entire army retreated back home, stimmed up to actually get back to deflect the Phoenix from killing off the second medevac, which sucks because if you just lost your first medevac, the last thing you want to have happen is to have your entire army stimmed up and then have to use all of your remaining medevac energy just to heal back up. And that's actually a nice pickoff.
Tank production now on the way for Dream, so he's going to have some artillery behind to deal with the Colossus. If he could get rid of the Phoenix, that would be pretty huge. It's not that many of them, and the Marines should be able to chase these Phoenix away. Second Forge is coming in there for Astraea, and he's thinking about a fourth base. Both players at a very high supply count right now, and an armory does go down for Dream. So I think Dream might just play single eBay all game, which I actually really like. I think too many players they're so obsessed with double upgrades, but then they have this massive gap between 1-1 and 2-2 starting. It's like, hey, why not just start them straight away? This Observer for Astraea, though, sees Ooh. Everything gathering. It feels like Astraea has a bit too much information, and that's what I don't like. I really think Dream needs to get out there and start clearing up the map vision, putting the pressure on Astraea. Can't let him get this fourth base for free.
Let's go, Astraea. Hasn't lost a single unit this game so far. Is going to be picking off yet another medevac potentially over here. Oh, he's just going to be looking for some of the free damage. Finally loses his first unit. That first Phoenix goes down over there. But, I mean, really causing a lot of havoc and concern as Dream. I think he finished knocking down those rocks, but just didn't quite have the extra APM to go after the rest of the things that Astraea had getting set up, like the fourth base and everything.
Oh, no.
Astraea catch an army off guard. Let's go.
Oh, but he could get flanked. Oh, good force fields on the right side. Very good force fields on the right side there. Not enough Vikings or anything like that to really deal with the Colossus. Dream has good numbers, but he cannot chase into a choke point. He's got to get out of there now, as he doesn't have many medevacs. Remember, he's lost so many medevacs in this game. Three already, and two Vikings have gone down for just one Phoenix. So this is really the one thing that's biting Dream in the ass very hard. And he's got a 4 CC almost finished, so he maintains an economy lead. But he's so low on hit points, and he's just behind on the tech. And I think this heavily favors Astraea. That being said, come on, man. Let my prophecy be true. Astraea, big army lead. Throw it away. Throw it into an arc of bio. I want to see a 360-degree surround. Marauders in a big old line where splash damage doesn't matter. And I want to see Astraea's army get thrown away here.
Dream is still just trying to buy a little bit of time to heal up his army. The Phoenix come in and are going to be able to find the Ghost. The Ghosts look like they went for some EMPs, but still quite a few of the Phoenix actually still have energy, so maybe not the most successful. Does pick off another one of the Phoenix. Astraea might actually finally be losing most of these Phoenix, so they aren't going to be nearly as effective, but it looks like Astraea's going to go for his big move out here.
Yeah, he's got some balls in there, so he's going to start chipping away. And because Dream lost of his tanks before, it's very unfortunate. Looks like one more Phoenix deep in the red, not quite going down. Watch out for the balls. No!
No!
No! Puck Protoss! Dirty! Dirty! Bad! Bad Protoss! Well, bad!
Turns
Puck
out
Protoss.
That Astraea might sometimes throw a little bit when he's ahead, but Dream manages to throw even further when he's behind.
Is that what you guys were practicing in your group shower before, was it? Taking your balls out and putting them on each other. Jesus! Fear Dragon!
Well,
disgusting!
You know, I feel like I'm feeling okay about how things are going right now. Another Disruptor goes out and Astraea picks up the W for 5 Shades of Protoss. We're heading to map number 5.
That's illegal. Give him a red card, Wardy. That was unhygienic at the very least. That was not a hygiene. No. Ugh. There should be some sort of punishment for that. No red card. There should be a red card. What the hell, referee? You watching the same game as us? Jesus.
I'm loving it. I am loving it right now. Beautiful job by our two American boys, Neeb and Astraea, picking up the W's. Now we're going to go back to another, I will say, like really good PvT player in Zhaun as he goes on and absolutely dumpsters Kier in this next match. That I'm excited about. I know you feel like, you know, Kier is a really good player, and I'll say he's an okay player. You know, Kier has done well for himself, but can he defeat Zhaun, someone who I will say is actually killing it in TVP right now?
That's a really good point, actually, Fear Dragon. So, you know, I'm just going to message Kier really quickly here as I hop over to the Korean server. And I've asked him, do you have a fever or some sort of form of other sickness or physical ailment? He says, no, I feel good. Oh, okay. No, I'd say you have a 2% chance of Zhaun winning then, mate. Zhaun could be on his absolute best day. And unless Kier is literally sick, nothing's going to happen, mate. There's no way at all. You think he could take down Kier, the guy who literally, if it wasn't for Maru, probably would have won like 4 of the last GSLs in the last 2 years. Come on, man. This is not a fair match. I mean, if top level Zhaun shows up, 1 in 50, 2%. That's what I'll give you, mate.
I'm actually just so disappointed you missed the opportunity where you were setting up for this pun around cure and sickness and stuff, and you just didn't go for it. I'm so heartbroken right now, Pig. I don't even have another response.
Some of us, like I said, high road, low road. You dragon, this is what I'm talking about. Some people always take the low road. They go, puns, you know, lowest common denominator humor.
The lowest form of humor, puns.
Just go for it. Go for it. They're like, punny. It's so punny. You know, I'm like, no, it's, you know, I resist those urges. And this is why my team is better than yours. It's because unlike players who said, Protoss, easy race. We're just going to throw disruptors through the fog and hope he's not looking. Lol, lol, lol. Server advantage, US West versus a Korean player while I live in San Diego. Ha, ha, ha. You know, our players actually practice. We've got three Terrans. Terran is objectively the hardest race in StarCraft 2. They have to click more, faster, harder, better. And because of that hard practice, Cure is going to destroy Zaun.
I just want it to go on record that Pig's definition of lowbrow humor is puns, and his definition of highbrow humor is taking people to Dicktown.
That's not humor, that's just a factual description of the objective reality of certain video game scenarios, Fear Dragon.
I'm taking them to Dicktown in a video game.
Astraea just teabagged Dream. I'm not happy about that. I wouldn't describe it that way unless it was factually correct, but that is what we just witnessed, is it not? Am I lying?
Oh,
I
don't think so. I've missed you, Pig. I've missed you. All right, guys, we're heading into
Fear Dragon.
Map number 5. This is our ace match. Who's going to end up winning the series over here? We are going to be starting up in the top left-hand side of Berlingrad on top of our purple Protoss player saying, Sal, Sal, he is Zhaun.
I think they're both fans of Upper Tree Zelda. That's what they're referring to there. And in the bottom right, representing Dragon Phoenix Gaming and the War Pigs, pink as a pig and ready to slay. It's Cure. So only lost one game so far in the team league, and it was a 30-minute plus.
He's only lost 50% of his matches so far.
Yep, to Maru.
To Maru, that's fair.
In a game that came down to a few two battle cruisers that refused to die yesterday. It was actually a sick TVT. But it's kind of cool, mate. We started off 2-0. You guys have won 2 in a row. We're coming down to game 5. We get that exciting decider match. It's what people want to be seeing.
Yeah.
What the 2-gate? What is this?
Let's go, Zhaun. Mixing it up. Been a little unpredictable. Where's your SCV scout? We're not gonna get a scout on this until the Reaper.
Oh no. Oh man.
Oh, he is gonna send out an SCV scout. Alright.
Okay, yeah, okay. And the Nexus is gonna be late enough that it tells him what he needs to know. Yeah, this should be okay. Does he cancel the command center though? Hopefully not. No Zealot coming out, so the response here for Cure is to just drop a bunker ASAP and make sure that bunker's not too far from the ramp, I guess. I don't know if it's gonna be Stalkers or Adepts.
That's a good question. I mean, let's see, it's gonna be Adepts. I mean, I don't hate that. Adepts can be pretty nice, just putting on the pressure and stuff after there's a, when you think that there's gonna be a bunker coming up since there's an SCV scout.
I kind of feel like, yeah, I don't know. It sounds just like, oh man, I didn't want you to scout this, bro. this is like, it's not every day I see a high level Protoss do Zooka's beginner Protoss build order that most Gold League players that I coach open with. Yeah, I swapped the Stalkers for Adepts, but yeah, this is literally a beginner build order Fear Dragon. I mean, you're going to be desperate to pull one of these out. What is he thinking, man?
Back to basics, Pig. Back to basics. You know, sometimes you got to bring it back to the basics to show people just how much better you are than the other player.
Oh,
that SDV already taking a hit from the probe is going to get one shot by 2 Adepts. Nicely done.
Dude, that command center is on 71 out of 71. Can someone explain? Blizzard, hello? Do you know how to count numbers? Hello?
It's not Blizzard so much as it's just Terran players not very good with numbers, you know, fractions not, it's a little bit above their pay grade. So our commander is going to continue to be stalled out here for so long because these Marines have been getting picked off and everything. So it isn't that much firepower. Now there's 4 Adepts over here. He's going to knock down the supply depot soon. Gets the Reaper. Hell yeah.
Such stupid build order getting rewarded. Easy A move race.
Okay,
so
calm down, Idra.
So
calm
dumb.
Down.
Getting rewarded for inferior
Look
play.
Look at this micro. Look at this micro. Keeping all the Adepts alive. Oh, he's finally going to start shading out. Potentially going to be moving out. But, I mean, Yeah, the damage has been done already. What is that? 22 workers for cure, an unfinished command center. Zhaun is getting a blink. He's getting up stalkers. Zhaun, we're already opening up the soju bottles, man. You can actually join us at the after party for this.
On any other map, that command center finishes, but Berlingrad, with mining open the minerals, man, it's such a quick rush distance, and that is very frustrating for Cure. He's gonna have to play like a god to come back from here. Zhaun is way ahead. That command center getting delayed there is just so unlucky. Because even if he just popped his SCV back into the bunker, if he played it safe, he would have been able to finish it, right? Because the adepts can't punish the ramp and pick it off. So Cure is like, nah, it's gonna finish. And that one decision sometimes does end up costing you in a game of StarCraft. He really wants to hide the bio. He's like, please shade in here. Come on, dude. You know you want to throw these adepts away. Four stalkers coming as well. Is he going to try and bust the bunker? Please try and bust the bunker. Throw your stalkers away.
He's going to have blink in a second. So, I mean, I don't hate him just poking just because, well, I guess actually now Stim is done. So it is really dangerous, but he's going to poke on forward. Gets the Marauder. That's a nice pickoff. I would actually say, you know, exchanging a depth for a Marauder, I don't hate it.
Well, Zhaun is not getting any tech right now. As I say, the forge does go down. And by the way, have you been calling him Zhaun?
Yeah, you know, I'm one of those people that I've heard too many pronunciations for him, and now I don't actually know what to call him anymore. Because there's Zhaun, there's Zhaun, there's whatever Artosis keeps saying, which I think is actually the one that he wants to be called, but I can never remember.
I know Tasteless says Zhaun, I think. I don't know. I'm just going to go with Zhaun. He's going to, you know, he takes his opponents to Zhaun Town. I like it. It rolls off the tongue.
To Zhaun Town.
Yeah, man. All right. These adepts getting good vision. I mean, Cure's getting decent economy up, but does not have a third started. It's almost 6 minutes. I mean, Zhaun is going for a very low tier army, right? He's just Stalker, Zealots, Immortals, but he's got the plus one upgrade in there. And he's got that third base up. He's not probing nonstop, but if Cure can, I don't know, do something fancy with drops or get a, you know, turtle up to late game, there's a few things that he can do here. It's just right now, these adepts are giving, of course, a big vision advantage. And I think after the next shade, we're going to see Cure actually try and stim on these stalkers and adepts and just see if he can kill a few of them. I just think at this point, you kind of need to get the Protoss off your doorstep. So third command center goes down in the main. He scans the natural, sees the lack of gas. Does he see the Robo Bay? No, he doesn't see the Robo Bay, which is unfortunate. That really tells you that he's transitioning.
Oh man, Zhaun is actually being super aggressive with these stalkers against a very scary army right now, but he's able to get a free couple of marine pickoffs, and he's been able to keep a lot of these units further back. He hasn't been losing any of these stalkers as well. Gets a little bit low on hit points with one of them, but the adepts manage to shade into the main base, picking off a couple of workers. Are you kidding me? What a god. How does he manage to get all this damage done during all this while the stalkers also continue to try and poke forward and pick off some more marines?
Colossus is going to be coming out along with extended Thermalance. Cure fighting from behind. He's down 14 SCVs right now over the probes. He's going to try and sneak a drop out. It's a good move, but budget spotters out of the map. Those pylons on the edges will spot the drops coming. So he's going to have to just use his drop to kind of clear up pylons, get a bit of map control, and he's going to need to start working his way into Vikings in the near future as well. So I think he needs to probably stop it. Four medevacs, really, but most players want to build more than that, and so he's going to be tempted to go to six. I think the right call, though, is to get Vikings. That being said, he doesn't have the info we have. He doesn't know about that Colossus. Didn't see, he saw a gas missing on the natural, so he's like, oh yeah, maybe you're playing Zealot Stalker for ages. Got to be careful. He was going to move forward and start poking out with an army, but he's in a very rough position, so there we go. You see the drop gets spotted by the pylon. Has to now just use this to clear up vision. He'll see what he can do with that.
Prism heading to the main base also. At the same time that this army moves on forward, we're going to see Zhaun getting ready to be on the defensive as well as the offensive over here as we see the Zealots dropping over into the main base as Zhaun is doing a good job keeping this army from actually being able to push into the third base.
Yeah, I mean, Q is very good at PvT, but he does like to play this pure bio mine style. And when you're this far behind on army, it's not a style that you can really use defensively. It has to be used aggressively. But that plays into the fact that Zhaun has a better army right now, losing so many add-ons here. Three add-ons, two that we're building, and the other one burns down. Zealots continue to be annoying. Zaun has so much freedom right from the opening. Getting that command center delay has just absolutely given him a massive amount of momentum. And this is why the Reaper opening is, of course, not as popular against all these weird different aggressive things. It's because the Reaper just takes so long to build. It delays your Marines, your reactors getting out. And it's a bit better than a Marine at fighting, but not worth two Marines worth of build time in the early game. So now with the second Robo coming out, Cured knows he's going to have to turtle up, play it slow, get out the Vikings, add the Ghosts eventually, look for the perfect engagements. But he's really hoping that Zaun is going to shit the bed.
Yeah, I think at this point he kind of has to rely on Zaun making some kind of big flub that he can capitalize on. We do see, I mean, the Vikings and everything starting to get up into like slightly higher numbers and stuff, but Zaun is still adding on more of these Colossus with plus two weapons also finishing up. Another Robo finishing up. I mean, it's Zaun's game to lose at this point. He is already starting to make that transition as well. So I think the question to me is Cure just going to actually start trying to go to like total turtle mode or something, or is he gonna hit final max out point with some ghosts and then try and make something happen?
Yeah, I mean, max out bio ghosts, 1-1 Vikings, it can work, obviously. Mm-hmm. It can, but it's kind of tough. He did take out the prism with the Vikings, which was nice. It gives him a little edge here, but what a very hard situation he finds himself in. There's four Colossus, he's only got six Vikings. You want to have 10, maybe even 12 Vikings, you could argue for, if there's four Colossus out, seeing at least a few of these units, but the army is well split by Zaun. Zaun going to a fourth base, second eBay and armory on the way. So Cure is looking to just kind of progress to the next step. And this does put pressure on Zaun to find the trades. So Zaun has played a very good defensive mid game so far, but he's going to have to get aggressive at some point. Otherwise, Cure will max out and catch up. Of course, Cure does not have ranged libs. He doesn't have siege tanks. So you could argue that Zaun, with the balls coming out two at a time, you know, he's got kind of the better ranged siege army. Oh, he can't lose this triple drop. Careful, careful, Cure. Hide.
Ooh, army's going to get pounced upon with all these blink suckers so close to the bio. There is not really a lot of escape over here. So all of these units are going to go down. Marauders try and focus fire down some of the stalkers. So I like that decision. Just try and get some maximum value there, but not really finding a whole lot. And well, now the most that Cure could hope for is that he knows where the army is, so he can try and get defensively set up for this attack. But he's now down 30 army supply right as Zaun is getting ready for a little push-in.
Yeah, that sets up so well for the finish. I mean, Widowmine does take out the Disruptor before it could fire. That's kind of sick. And that Widowmine is still up front. And oh man, Disruptors do manage to land pretty well. Cure should not be diving on this. I mean, he feels like he's got to jump out there. He can't just eat the shots and get chipped away at. And actually, EMP's jumping on it, taking out a lot of units. Zealot run by does go in though. Oh, flanking ball!
Not bad. All right, chips away some of the army, is gonna force Cure back while the Zealot harass is starting to get cleaned up over here. But I mean, I still feel like Zaun, he didn't take the best of trades over there, but I think he's still in a pretty good position.
Yeah, Zaun is still in the lead for sure, but plus two weapons starting up, plus two armor as well. Stargate and DT transitions on the way for Zaun, but as long as Cure can just keep his army together, it's still survival mode for him. And here comes this army at the front. Cure does not know about it. Cure's got to gather his stuff together and get ready to sandwich this army. He is ready to come in from two sides. Zaun's got to be careful about getting sandwiched.
Oh god, those EMPs covered the entire Protoss army. Zaun is gonna need to create a little bit of distance, and that's something that Disruptors are very good at doing. A lot of this Bioforce really pushed back, but Disruptors are gonna get picked off. So are some of the Colossus over here. So Cure finding a bit of life at the end of this kind of situation in this game, but I think with the reinforcements and the shield battery, Zaun is still gonna be getting back to safety.
I like that he's continuing to bring Widow Mines and put them everywhere. It just makes it awkward for Zaun to get back out across the map. Cure is, of course, still down in army supply. The upgrade advantage, 3-1 versus 1-1 in favor of Zaun, is very scary. This is still a mostly Zealot army. There's only one Colossus, one Immortal, a few Disruptors and Stalkers. So with EMPs, you know, and Bio in a big ball, you can absolutely smash that army. But you can see just how preemptive Cure kind of stims in EMPs, because he's very worried about those Zealots just flanking and getting on top of him and spreading out where the EMPs can't really land.
Yeah, it's definitely a scary situation. Oh, man, I wish that Observer was here. The Disrupt or the Widowmine's gonna get another shot off on some of the disruptors. Finally is going to be able to clean that up. Just these two or three disruptors really have a lot of work cut out for them, but finding another little snag there, that's very nice. Two more disruptors are going to be joining the fray. I don't think Zaun's going to be able to break this location, but he's continuing to just chip away at things little by little and just making things difficult for Cure. While I love the important things behind all this, he is continuing to take additional expansions to get up a better economy, to actually increase his upgrades as well.
Cure is once again looking for that big flank, but you can see Zaun's poking in, poking out. He wants to bait Cure into big balls. I think Cure might need to split his army further deeper on the map to really get a big 270 surround, because the disruptor count's up to 6 and Tempest's now coming out. Those are going to just pick away at Cure and say, hey, you have to come and fight me. Of course, Tempests don't have a really good bang for their buck in terms of damage output or anything like that. So, you know, they're okay, but they're not absolutely god tier or anything like that. Disruptor zoning here. Cure is out. He's got a giant spready of units. He's taken down these rocks. He might just be able to F2 this.
Oh, we're going to see the Zealots actually forcing a lot of this battle forward. Gets a massive disruptor hit. There is a big concave over here for Cure that he has to be, looks like Zaun has to be very careful of. Disruptor is not really able to get into the mix at the same time. Finally, he's able to zone things back. I think the Tempest should be popping out soon to help reinforce alongside some more disruptors. Does Zaun actually have enough over here with a shield battery overcharge to push this army back? I think so.
Oh, Q is doing such a good job of hanging in here, though. He's taking really good fights. Tempests are now out. They're an annoying unit. They're not a high impact unit. They're not high in the damage or anything like that. But of course, still up in the army supply. It's mostly Zealots. But it's got disruptors in the back as well. Only 5 of them. That is still very scary. And the Tempest starting to rain down damage consistently from the back line. Bio coming in. This fight will decide the game, Fear Dragon.
Yeah, no Zealots involved in the army anymore. It's just the Stalkers and the Disruptors and the Tempest. And, well, it looks like the Bio Force is really starting to find better and better trades. But the Zealot reinforcements finally come on forward. And we're starting to see that things are favoring Zaun a little bit more and more. If even just a little bit of this army ends up trading out relatively evenly, a little bit one for one, then Zaun's going to feel pretty good about things because he just has the superior economy. He can reinforce a lot better. And now he's in the critical position. He's defending his opponent's base. And that is not a position a Terran player wants to be in against disruptors.
Yeah, no, I mean, it was just tech disadvantage all game long. Cure fought so hard from behind, but in the end, Zaun is just able to overwhelm him. He was trading just a little worse all game long, but when you're up on, six plus bases up against the Terran who's barely got his fourth up all game, that's a good way to play. So really nice transition into the Tempests, and man, 71 out of 71. F's in chat for the 71 out of 71 command center.
Yeah, I do feel for Cure a little bit on that one, but I also am feeling pretty good for my boys, the 5 Shades of Protoss. We're putting that first W on the board, the first of many, to be sure.